When we try to do a science of consciousness, we have to start with some kind of definition. And there's a very basic definition of consciousness, which I like, which is, for a conscious system, it feels like something to be that system. It feels like something to be me, it feels like something to be you, it feels like something to be a bat, as the philosopher Tom Nagel said. Mm-hmm. But the intuition is it doesn't feel like anything to be a table or a chair or a bicycle or a robot at the moment. For those systems, there's no experience happening. This is a very intuitive definition of consciousness. There's any kind of subjective experience whatsoever. And one reason it's important to have such a simple definition is that it prevents us mistakenly associating consciousness with other things, foremost among which is intelligence. So previously, a lot of people have thought that consciousness and intelligence are very, very intimately coupled, and that maybe you have to be intelligent like a human, assuming we are intelligent, which is questionable, to be conscious. And maybe consciousness is associated with language or with abstract thinking, playing chess, something like that. But no, I don't think that's true at all. Consciousness is much more basic. It doesn't require intelligence, doesn't require an explicit sense of self even. And one of the implications of this is that artificial intelligence, with computers as we have them now or in the near future, is one question whether they're intelligent in any real way, but they're certainly not conscious. And just making artificial intelligence smarter isn't going to make them suddenly conscious. I mean, it's a very different thing. We are machines, we're biological machines of vast, immense complexity, but fundamentally, we're made of stuff, and that's all there is. And the big question is, how come this complicated biological machine can account for, generate, and give rise to these rich world of subjective experiences that we have? But fundamentally, I take a very, if you like, materialist perspective, thinking of the brain as a system, as a physical system, and then trying to figure out how to map parts of the system, processes that unfold within the system, that can explain aspects of experience that we have. This is a bit different from looking for some magic dust or magic source that actually creates experience and magically generates it. No, we have experiences, this is true, and we are complex machines. And the challenge is to find the best links between the two that help us explain one in terms of the other. We have this intuition that consciousness is not the kind of thing that can be explained in terms of mechanisms, in terms of stuff. It seems to us that consciousness is this special mental stuff that however much we know about the brain, we'll never be able to understand why and how there's any kind of experience associated with it. This has been called the explanatory gap in neuroscience. It's been called the hard problem of consciousness by David Chalmers, another philosopher. It certainly seems that there's this gap, but the challenge is to close it as much as we can and then see if there's any gap left. And I think it's a mistake to decide now, from where we are now, with what we know now, and decide that science and philosophy together won't be able to fully cross this gap. I think we're already making progress, and we're doing it by not treating consciousness as a single big mystery, but identifying its different properties and trying to say something about each of those. Now, a similar thing happens in the philosophy and science of life. It wasn't that long ago that people thought life could never be explained in terms of physics or chemistry. It had to be an elan vital, a spark of life. I don't know how you say it in Spanish. There must be something equivalent, something of vida. But of course, so there was a hard problem of life 150 years ago. It couldn't be explained by physics and chemistry, but of course it can. And now people don't see a hard problem of life. We don't know everything about life, but there's no mystery that it is a property of physics and chemistry and biology. And that's because biologists sort of looked at the different properties that living systems have, metabolism, reproduction. And I think a very similar strategy might work for consciousness. We don't try and look for the magic spark of consciousness. We try to explain its properties. And even if this isn't successful, even if there's still a gap, you know, maybe in 50 years there'll still be a gap, maybe in 100 years there'll still be a little gap. Well, okay. So that might just be that there's a limit to how far science and philosophy can get. That's also fine. In physics, nobody has told us why there's a universe, but that's fine. You know, we just understand the limits of what we can say. And also, we will have made a lot of progress. We'll have understood a lot more about consciousness. An understanding of how the brain forms perceptions and how the brain forms beliefs about whether a perception is real or not. I think these are key questions in consciousness science that have a direct relevance for some of these wider issues in society about what do we trust, who do we trust, what's real, what's not. But what neuroscience is adding to the picture is this idea that the brain is always actively making predictions about what's out there in the world and using sensory data to update, to calibrate its predictions. And my claim is that what we experience is the predictions. It's the content of what the brain is, from the inside out, predicting about the world. And the sensory data is just there to keep these predictions tied to the world in ways that are useful for the organism. And this is why I like the term controlled hallucination, because hallucinations we typically think of as false perceptions, when people experience things that are not real, that are not there, that other people don't, that come from within. But my point is that all our experiences come from within. It's just that in normal perception, these predictions come from within and that they're controlled by the world and by the body, so they're useful. So that's why I use the word controlled hallucination. And it gives us a way of understanding why particular experiences are the way they are, you know, why visual experiences have the kind of character they do with objects in places and spaces between them, but other kinds of perception have different properties. I don't think we have the slightest idea how to build something that is actually conscious. We might do it by accident, which would be a big ethical disaster. I think what's much more likely to happen, and in fact is already happening, is that with advances in AI, we're getting close to building systems that at least when you interact with them on a screen, can appear to be conscious. It can give us a strong impression that we're interacting with an intelligent, conscious agent. That's very close. And I think that in itself is going to be quite problematic, because once we're faced with that sort of situation, it'll be very difficult for us to appreciate, to really understand that there is not necessarily any actual consciousness there. One of the very prominent features of the human mind is we tend to project consciousness and intelligence and the things that we think of as human-like into things that seem to be similar to us. You know, we're anthropomorphic in this sense. We tend to project qualities that we have onto animals that are more similar to us and less so to animals that are less similar to us. And so AI plays an interesting and I think quite dangerous role here, because we are building them specifically to look similar to us so that we can talk to them with chatbots and then we can animate faces and so on with deepfakes. And that's going to be problematic, because we might end up laboring under a kind of cognitive illusion that we cannot get underneath. It's like there are lots of visual illusions that, you know, two lines might look different lengths and they turn out to be the same length. And even when you know this is the case, they still continue to look different lengths. I mean, so we knowing something is the case doesn't change how we experience it for some things. And this might be exactly what happens with near future AI, that we know, or at least we know that we have no good reason to think that it's conscious, But just as we can't help seeing two lines as different lengths, we might not be able to help really experiencing the AI as being conscious. And that's going to be very difficult to deal with. I think what's changed, certainly in the 20 or so years that I've been working in this area, is that it's become a much more legitimate topic to study scientifically. Now, I was advised against focusing on consciousness because they said you'd never get a job or get any funding or you would be career suicide. It's still difficult, but that's no longer the case. And I think it's because we can demonstrably make progress. And we know a lot more now about the relationship between the brain and the body and consciousness than we did 20 or 30 years ago. And if you can show progress, then you can get a job and you can get money. And that means, you know, that legitimacy within science and philosophy, and actually the bringing together, the fact that these core questions now bring researchers together from philosophy, from neuroscience, from mathematics, from computer science, that also really helps. If consciousness was purely within philosophy or purely within something else, then it would be, I think its reach would be much less. And then there are other concepts like the soul. You know, that comes more from spiritual traditions and religion. And here I'm actually a bit more sympathetic. You know, I think there's something about the most basic experience of self that's below a name, below the memories that we have, beneath the experience of the object that is my body, beneath even the moods and emotions that come and go, that is still there, this very basic feeling of being alive that in my work and in my book I've come to the idea that that's the root of all our conscious experiences. They're all fundamentally grounded in this very, very basic brain perception of the physiological state of the body. And thinking about what that might mean in experience, I think you get quite close to what people describe as at least from some spiritual traditions, as soul. But it's not the kind of soul that is, you know, a little essence of you that could leave your brain and body and go and reappear in another body in another generation, survive death. No, it's a very different kind of soul that speaks much more to the experience of being a living organism. There's a lot of reason for optimism. As our understanding of the brain basis of consciousness develops, we're going to get improved ways of diagnosing and treating psychiatric problems, neurological problems, things like psychosis, possibly things like Parkinson's disease and dementia. I mean, these are all, you know, really massive challenges for medicine, and an understanding of consciousness has something to say about these. We can also perhaps treat better people who have had severe brain damage, who lose consciousness. And then I think there's also a note of optimism more personally for the rest of us, more existentially. You know, we by understanding that consciousness is a natural biological phenomenon, and by understanding the self as not this sort of permanent essence of you or me, but as a continuously evolving, impermanent set of perceptions of the body, I think we can, you know, we can be much more comfortable with ourselves over time, and also perhaps even more comfortable with the prospect of mortality, with the prospect of the end of life. And these kinds of recognitions really do parallel a lot of thinking in the spiritual traditions like meditation and Buddhism that talk a lot about impermanence and different ways of thinking about the self. And I think this convergence between neuroscience of consciousness and some of these perspectives on the self, on life, and on consciousness will be, you know, very beneficial for us. Overall, the less that we think of ourselves as humans as special and apart from the rest of nature and sort of inhabiting a different realm, the more we see ourselves as continuous with the rest of nature, as part of it, as sharing properties with it, as consciousness being grounded in life, then I think we're more at home in our worlds and we can be more at peace with ourselves.